right, so I received my copy of ISOM number 1 a couple of days ago, and I've read it twice now. I just finished the reread. You know, I wanted to read it one more time before I did this review slash impression. So, like I said, I got it a couple of days ago, and right off the bat, you see it's a very high quality production. The box it comes in has the Ribbiverse logo on it, professionally done. Like, it's not like some little stickers like slapped on there. You know, it's on the actual cardboard, and it's a sturdy cardboard. You open it up, there's a little inner sleeve that holds the book itself. The comic comes in a, you know, the classic bag and board, and it kind of reminds me of My Comic Shop. They do a great job of sending comics, you know, properly secure and whatnot. The book itself, just looking at it, I don't know, use pictures that I took on my phone, but I don't really like the quality of the lighting. The cover is, I don't know if it's cardstock or what, but this is a professional book. Like, it's put together professionally. The light reflects off the cover. So my reading lamp, when I was trying to take pictures, you know, the light was bouncing off, so you really couldn't get the full image. So yeah, the cover is great. The paper quality is great. You can tell that Ripa, you know, spared no expense in putting this book together. So I think a nice touch, when you open the book, there's ISOM fighting some dudes on the inside cover. Looks like it's some guys from Alpha Corps. But if that's the case, they don't seem to have superpowers. These guys look like they're grunts, unless they're part of like the police department, like a special forces unit or something. So he's fighting these guys, beating up on these guys on the inside cover. First page is ISOM or Avery with his niece on his shoulders. They're both looking happy and smiling. And so, you know, you've got that contrast between him whooping on people's asses and, you know, having like his family connection with his niece. So that's pretty cool. Another really cool thing about it. So the name of the story is Ill-Advised Part 1. ISOM, Ill-Advised Part 1. Eric July, writer. Cliff Richards, artist. Gabe Al-Tayeb, colorist. And then you have letterer Eric Weathers, Alan Ford, Carol Brown, the copy editor. And Marcos Rios is the concept artist. So Ripa has this foreword in the book. Let's see. I might try to read it all. Let's see. I'd like to thank every single supporter, fan, and colleague that has helped make my many dreams come true. But this comic book venture is easily the most ambitious project that I've had the blessing of committing to. The state of the American comic book industry has been in an unfortunate spot, and I want it to be part of the solution. This subculture has given me countless memories, stories, and has been a bridge to lifelong friends. I will not stand idle as bad actors attempt to run it into the ground. So here's something for every longtime customer that went to the comic book shop every Wednesday. For all the people that have watched their favorite franchises be hijacked. For each person that always wanted to get into an ever-expanding universe, but just didn't know where to start. And for all of those that simply want to invest in creators that don't hate them. Welcome to the Ripperverse. This is the launching pad, and just the beginning. I hope you enjoy ISOM, this story, and the other characters that are introduced in the books. Eric D. July. So, yeah, when I first heard him, I'm moving away from the mic, putting the comic book down. Why did I even do that? I'm just being careful where I place the book because I don't want to mess it up. But when I first heard him talk about Ripperverse, at first I thought it was going to be a comic book about him, like the image, that comic book image he has on a lot of his stuff. So I was like, but that doesn't make sense. Like, the more you hear him talk about it, it's like, this is not going to be like this vanity project where it's just a character, it's just him as a character going to beat people up, and it looks like some kind of, you know, like some kind of fake superhero ad that they put in comic books or something. I thought that doesn't make sense. He's not going to do that. So I'm not surprised at the production quality of this, but I'm still impressed with it. So I'm not surprised, but impressed with it. Now, the actual story itself. Now, I said in a previous video, I guess when I was talking about the trailer, that I'm not expecting, you know, Watchmen or Frank Miller Daredevil run or John Byrne Fantastic Four. I'm not expecting anything like that. I don't need that. I don't need this amazing story. If it's a solid 3-star book, you know, especially from a first time comic creator, first issue. I'm fine with that. All I want is just a good superhero comic without any bullshit in it. Like, but we already know. Yeah. So overall, my impression of the book is extremely positive. The story is good. The art's good. Colors are great. Like, it's a good book. It really is. Let me see. I'm trying to. All right. So I just thought something was interesting. I'll point out a couple of things. It starts off simple. You know, they're in the police precinct, and I guess the mayor, or is it the governor? Some politician, these cops are watching on the television talking about how, you know, crime has gone down since he's been in office. And I guess the police chief or something is like complaining about not getting credit for helping crime go down. And one of the characters mentions, because they, you know, the guys who are with this police chief start saying things like, well, he did finally reroute those funds. Former Governor Schrack left the South Side high and dry. And we can't forget about those masked weirdos helping us out from time to time. They've been killing it lately. And then the guy goes, have you seen the chick with the red hair? She could do some things to me. So what I thought was interesting about that was that's not Yaira. Yaira's blonde. And it's not Ingrid Valdez, one of the members of Alpha Corps. So there's apparently some hot redhead that's somewhere in the Ripperverse. I bet you the person whoever got those damn trading cards, which I just couldn't justify spending the money on, whoever got those damn trading cards probably sees that character. I should Google it just to see if somebody posted images of it. But anyway, so very simple. Starts are very simple, very clean. Gives you a little bit of sense of people being aware of, you know, excepts, you know, superpowered beings in the world. Like, they're aware of it. No problem. Avery is immediately drawn into this situation where his sister, Altona, just, you know, is exactly what the trailers described. That story. An intern working with Altona got offered a job. She never called back after like 8 days. She just went missing. So Altona says, hey, go speak to Darren Fontana, who's like sort of a kingpin type guy. Speak to him, see if he knows anything about it. And I'm not going to really do any spoilers. You know, it's just, like I said, the story is exactly what he said it's going to be. Overall, I mean, it's good. I mean, I give it 3 stars. I don't want to, like I said, I don't want to spoil anything. I have a couple of little nitpicks. I think that the dialogue is sometimes clunky. Overall, it's good. And it's very clean for the most part. But there are some moments, like there's a moment when Isom goes to speak to Darren Fontana. I think that's his full name, the kingpin type dude. Darren's speech patterns, like overall, like I said, the dialogue is fun overall, but there's a couple of clunky things here and there. Like he goes, I'll award you such a warning, and that sounds a little bit off. Let me find the whole thing so I can kind of, like I said, I don't want to really reveal too much. It's very interesting. I think, like, besides the dialogue, which, like I said, it overall it's fine, but there are a couple of things. Let me see, I'm flipping to the part here. I don't want to say too much about this. It just says basically, we haven't connected in a while. So since we go back and all, I'll award you such a warning. Whatever's going on with Jasmine is none of your concern. So yeah, little things like that will pop up where it's a little bit off to me. It just doesn't sound right. I would be like, if I was the editor, I'd be saying, I would say, no, change, I'll award you such a warning to something else. So, and it happens a couple of times. There's a sequence where Avery's about to fight this guy for the second time that day. And the guy he's talking to, you know, he's an except, he's a superpowered being, and his speech pattern's a little bit loftier, I think, than it should be. Not because the dude's black, you know. I think that, you know, Ripper's purpose and some of this dialogue from some of them is to just show you that these are intelligent people. But I just feel like some of the word choices and some of the sentences just a little bit off, a little bit clunky once in a while. I think the worst offending part was the second time Avery is about to fight this dude, this particular dude. Well, it's a guy named Santuan. You know, we've seen enough images of it. So he's about to fight Santuan the second time that day. And I understand what the point of the conversation between the two of them is. And it's fine. You know, it's interesting. You know, they have a history beyond the book and the earlier fight. But it was just a little bit off. That's all. I don't know. It's almost like code switching in a way. Like, certain things they say, particularly Santuan, Darren, and Avery, like their voice, like Avery's voice, you can almost get Avery's voice, but he does out of nowhere, like one moment he sounds a certain way, and in another moment, he'll say something like, Do not credit heroism when all this takes place. Blame yourselves, but credit me. That sounds really, you know what he's saying, right? But it just sounds like a little too highfalutin for Avery. And again, not because Avery's black. It just, and people code switch all the time. You know, black people code switch all the time. But I feel like Avery's talking to Santuan, who's black, or at least he looks black. He might be an alien, because Santuan does it too. On one moment, Santuan will be like, I ain't got to do nothing but drag you out. And then the very next moment, he'll be like, I told them we should have ensured your defeat. But even I didn't think you'd be dumb enough to come right back. This is why you heroes often end up dead. Which, you know, that's fine. Like, that's fine. But it just seems like, wait a minute, you sounded like, you know, you was a menace to society one moment. And now you sound like Dr. Doom. So, it's, you know, and like I said, it's just my own personal quirk. It's probably not that big a deal. But yeah, man, it's good. Beyond the dialogue being, you know, those little moments that I've had problems with the dialogue. And it's not that big of a deal, really isn't. If he doesn't ever change some of their speech patterns, I won't have a problem. It'll just stick out from time to time, that's all. But beyond that, the only other issue I have with it is that even at 96 pages or so, it feels too short. Like, it feels like it's just getting started. It's a proper first issue. So, you know, because of the business structure of this, you know, he's a small-time business owner. Very successful, but, you know, he's not going to be able to write the comics, get it drawn, and get it out on a monthly basis. At least not yet. I feel like he's ambitious enough to want to get to a point where he's able to put out a monthly book. At least for like 6 issues or something like that. So yeah, the biggest problem with all of this right now is just waiting for the next issue. Like I said, it's 3 stars out of 5. 3 out of 5, good. It's solid, but it's just getting started. I feel like it has the potential to get better. I don't think it's going to get worse. I think it's only going to get better. I like Avery. I like that he's not this grim, sullen guy. You know, he's not like cracking jokes like Spider-Man, but he's kind of funny in certain moments. Like, there's a moment where it's like, I'm tired of y'all holding me up like I'm some kind of rag doll, because he's not winning a lot of fights in this. You know, he is winning some fights, but he's, you know, it's interesting. He's not, you know, Galadriel in Rings of Power, riding upside down and chopping orcs up, you know, without thinking about it. Like, he has to, you know, he has to really dig in and fight if he wants to survive. So, good stuff. There's even a thought bubble in it. And I haven't seen a thought bubble in modern day comics since Walt Simonson's Ragnarok, which has thought bubbles. And it was great to see at least one thought bubble in a comic. This, it just, you could tell he loves comics, and he learned quite a bit from comics, because it's really done well. I mean, like I said, it's 3 stars only because it really does feel like it's just getting started. And it ends the main story. There's a little epilogue, but the main story ends the way you expect a first issue kind of to end, where it's like, get ready for part two, you know. So there was an ad, and I've watched a couple of other people. I know apparently there are people complaining about the ad in the book. So apparently it's his wife's ad. It's not like the end of the world. I just looked at it and was like, oh, I didn't expect to be seeing an ad here. And I guess because it feels like you're reading a trade paperback. But it's like, this is his wife's company. Like, who cares? Like, I have no problem with that ad being there. I mean, like, you're a married man. You love your wife. Your wife is helping you get these goddamn books out. You know, you've got your dream going. She's got her dream going. Like, why wouldn't you put your wife's, like, you absolutely have to put your wife's ad in a goddamn comic. Even if you think no one reading it, you know, would be interested in buying jewelry. You know, particularly if you're thinking men are the ones who'd be buying it. You need to put that ad in the damn book. There's no way you're not going to put your wife's ad in your book. Especially since it's, I think, to me, it adds to the whole kind of family small business dynamic of it. Like, what would she be doing as a wife who's starting her business if she wouldn't say, put my ad in your book because I want as many eyes on it as possible? Like, that's the move. You're supposed to do that. And it's no big deal. It's an ad. Comic books have ads. The ad makes perfect sense to be in there. It doesn't hurt the flow of the comic book at all. You would almost expect, if you're reading a normal old school comic, after the splash page to see an ad there and then go right back into. And it's a good way to kind of break between that splash page and into like what happens next, which is like a few hours later. So no problem with that. Overall, like I said, I give the book 3 stars. I could give it 4 stars just for the strength of the production. Like I said, the book quality. So maybe it's 4 stars because the quality of the book, the coloring, the paper, you know. So yeah, I'll give it 4 stars. 4 stars out of 5. Good story, clean, simple, smooth. So congratulations to Eric July. He deserves the success, not just because he put his own money up and he bet it on himself, but because he really did put something out that has quality. And like I said, I wasn't looking for a masterpiece. I was looking for something that's a good superhero. And my videos always go longer than I want them to. But I do have to say that, again, how necessary it is for someone to show a lot of these industry hacks, how you do inclusion and diversity. Isom's black. He's clearly black. You look at him, he's black. His sister is black. Darren Fontaine is black. Santos, but there's a lot of black characters in it. And they speak black dialect sometimes. And it's like, that's it. That's all you need to know. Like, there's nobody's complaining about being black. No one's whining about the history of slavery. None of that. They're just doing their thing. But this looks like there's some Asian people in there at one point who, I say look like Asian. I think they're Asian. There's an Asian couple at one point who are accepts. So one of them's definitely an accept. And so they've got their little subplot going. So he's just got naturally organic diversity and inclusion. And it's not, you know, virtue signaling. It's just still in service of telling just a good story.